This afternoon, we're going to hear from Dr. Shari Dunn-Norman. Dr. Norman received her MS in Petroleum Engineering from the University of Tulsa and her PhD in Petroleum Engineering. I'm not going to pronounce this. Harriet Watt University in Edinburgh, Scotland. She worked for 8 years for Atlantic Richfield Company, ARCO Exploration, and ARCO International in a variety of assignments, including foreign assignments in Indonesia and the UK. She is the author of a book and many papers on well construction methods and is currently head of program and associate professor of petroleum engineering at Missouri University of Science and Technology, where her research interests include well completion design, benchmarking and performance, offshore oil technology, and pipelines and production engineering. Dr. Norman is an expert on subsea pipelines in the petroleum industry and is here today to tell us a bit about the basics of oil and gas drilling, provide a framework for understanding the drilling and development risks oil and gas companies face in very deep water, and help explain what may have gone wrong for BP. Won't you please join me in welcoming Dr. Shari Dunn-Norman.
Well, welcoming today. I'm really glad to see so many of you here in such a wide variety. We have some young students here in the room, and I want to thank you for taking your time out of your day to come. Thank you very much. As Rose said, I wanted, when I started putting this talk together, to give you a framework, really. I mean, instead of just talking about the BP well, and so that's what today's talk is going to be designed for. And so today we're going to talk a little bit about the Gulf of Mexico in general, and I'll talk a little bit about production facilities, and then how pipelines move the crude to shore, and then what happens from there. From there, we'll talk about some of the simple physics of and the concepts of drilling. We'll move those concepts offshore, and I'll tell you about the mud weight window, and then we'll talk a little bit about the BP well, and then you can ask me all sorts of questions. I didn't design this talk to be political, so if you could hold your politics to the end, maybe that would be the best thing to do. Okay, here is a great picture, and this picture tells so many stories for you, so many important things. This is the Gulf of Mexico with the water drained out. Here's Florida, and all of these red dots you see are oil or gas facilities. And this is what we call the outer continental shelf. And we call it the outer continental shelf because it's relatively shallow sloping. And so in the early, probably 1950s, we began drilling this and producing this shallow, relatively shallow production. But what you see here is rapidly the continental shelf falls off. And so right now there are over 4,000 installations in the shallow OCS, and there are about 50-ish deep water fields that produce from deep water. Deep water, now people are going to argue about this, but this talk, deep water is 1,000 feet or more water depth. There are other people who are going to say 500 feet or more, or 1,500 feet or more, but this talk is focused on 1,000 feet being our demarcation. The star is where the BP Macondo well is actually located. And so this gives you an idea of the challenge that we're facing as we move out beyond this outer continental shelf where it plunges off. Here's the bathymetry lines. And this slide, I really it's hard for you to read the detail of this, so I'm just going to mention a few things. These are the discoveries that were made. And it was really, I guess, the mid-1970s when we started. These are just deep water. This is not the shallow stuff. In the 1970s, we began pushing the limits out to 1,000 feet of water and pushing the facility design out into 1,000 feet of water. And look at the bathymetry. Here's 1,000 feet. 1,500 feet, very close together. That's that plunging wall that you see, all the way down to 5,000 feet by the time you're at the seafloor. So everything in here is going to be in fairly challenging development scenario. And the 1990s were when we began to really drill and explore and find fields out into this. There's a whole geological reason for that too, which isn't really a part of this talk. Now, MSNBC and CNN they tend to mix terminology. They'll mix drilling terminology with production terminology. And so what you see in this slide are production facilities. And an important thing to know is that our drilling technology, drilling means making a hole in the ground, leads our production technology. So the drillers are drilling in more than 10,000 feet of water, whereas production facilities still are in the 6,000-7,000 feet of water. And actually, it's been the Brazilians who have really pushed a lot of the deep subsea technology. So let's take a look. This is a fixed platform, shallow OCS. The deepest one is in about, I think its name is Bullwinkle. Shell developed it in the 1970s, I think, late 70s. And it's in about 1,100 feet of water. But what happens with a fixed platform is when the wave hits it, it can't really move. If the period of the wave hits the platform, and it'll eventually fatigue the platform. You have to make the platform resistant to that fatigue. And so there's a practical limit. So we have something called a compliant tower that allows more of a compliant movement. But again, it's bottom supported. Now, these are production facilities. These are where the wells are going to be drilled off of or pre-drilled and tied back to. So when we get to water depths of about deep water, 1,000, 2,000, we're into these kinds of facilities. We're not putting fixed platforms out there. We're putting out platforms that are going to float and be tethered to the seafloor. This is called a tension leg platform. It floats, it's ballasted, and then it's tethered to the seafloor. And then they have different designs of them, and this is called a spar, and this is a floating production storage and offloading facility. Again, all of these are very similar. They have different concepts in their terms of storage and processing. For example, something like this isn't going to store the oil that it processes. It's going to separate it and put it in a pipeline. Whereas something like these scenarios down here, especially this ship with a tanker, a shuttle tanker, is going to separate the oil and send it to a tanker that's going to come and go periodically. So this will have storage capability, whereas this may not. Along about the 1980s, we began to put oil wells on the seafloor. I don't know how many of you are aware of this, but worldwide there's over 3,000 of these wells in major producing areas of the world. And that's what you see at the bottom of this picture is what's called a subsea well. So everything that you would normally see on land if you were driving across the United States or any other country, it's actually sitting on the seafloor. And then a flow line ties it back to a production facility. So this is just a picture of actually one of these crews here. So the deeper the water, the more challenging the production facility becomes, more expensive. The production facility separates oil, water, and gas. We generally don't put gas and oil in the same pipeline because it creates a much bigger friction pressure drop. And so having said that, I've got a really nifty picture here, which is from the what used to be the Minerals Management Service, now it's the Bureau of Ocean Management. And all of the red that you see here are high level, all the main pipelines from the offshore facilities, and not all the facilities are shown, not all 4,000. These are just the ones that are acting as the hub that the deep water is going to be producing to them as a hub through a lot of subsea wells. There's over 33,000 miles of pipeline littering the Gulf of Mexico. It's amazing, absolutely amazing. And sometimes in really shallow water, fishermen trolls come along and spend.
Pipeline under the seafloor?
On top. Some of them are trenched, some of them are dug in, but by and large, the really shallow stuff will all be laid, and some of them will be laid on top of each other. It's really amazing in shallow water, and so most of the marine industry has maps to show them where these lines are. And they're all different diameters as well, some of them are trunk lines. So in this photo, what you're seeing are main production facilities, like these will either be tension leg platforms. Well, these are probably main platforms, just big platforms. Out here would be more like the TLPs in the deeper water that are going to be expected to gather up production from these deeper facilities and move it on. So what happens from there then? Once the pipelines get it, well, they move it into the refinery, and the refineries are, as you saw in Hurricane Katrina, all located the Gulf Coast, Texas City, and New Orleans area. And so from there, the crude oil is refined into different products. And I just included a little barrel that shows you how many gallons of gasoline we basically get out of a barrel of crude. Well, a barrel of crude oil is 42 gallons. 42 gallons are in one crude barrel of crude oil. So we get about 20-ish gallons of gasoline and then these other products. And again, I started to talk about price and price comparisons, but I didn't really want to do that because I thought that you probably would have yourself. But we could talk about that if you want. From there then, once they're at the refineries, and this is just a little different view that I've taken, from the refineries then, the gasoline that sort of comes out of the refinery goes into a pipeline system. Some is by cargo tanker, some is actually taken by tanker away, but the dominant amount, probably 70% of it, goes by pipeline, and it gets distributed into the United States through pipeline systems. And those pipelines, there's between distribution lines and main pipelines, there's over 200 miles of pipeline throughout the United States as well. Gas transmission line, oil line. Again, we don't mix gas and oil and pipelines because we don't sell the product that way, and offshore it causes friction. Now, I can have colleagues that come in here and say, no, we're changing that, and indeed we're trying to develop multi-phase subsea pumping and things of that, but right now the majority of these wells are that production isn't combined. Okay, now here's a very, very important thing that nobody else knows, well, except for one person. Somebody who might know very well. This is a graph of the production from oil production from the Gulf of Mexico. And what year is it? You can't really read the numbers here, but here we are in 1953. This is when we began drilling just with barges. And so we started bringing production on. These are these 4,000 shallow installations that I was talking about. We reached a peak there in the 60s, fell off a little bit, came back with some redevelopment, and now all of those production facilities are on essentially a decline. There's some rejuvenation going on. This is from just 2005 or 6, but by and large, this production is declining. And in the 70s, when we began drilling, as I mentioned, the deep water fields beyond 1,000 feet. And look at what's happened. In 2001, the production from these deeper facilities crossed the production coming from the shallow. And now, about 60% of the Gulf of Mexico production is coming from those deep water facilities. 50-ish facilities, maybe 60, are producing more than the other 4,000. So when we say we're not going to drill there anymore, you can think about the implications of not drilling there anymore. Okay, now let's switch mode. Now I've given you the framework for us to go and talk about drilling a little bit. Now you've seen the Gulf and what's going on in the Gulf. Now we're going to talk about the physics of drilling. And there's some professors here and high-level people, so please I hope this doesn't bore you, but I just want to make sure everybody was grounded in the same way here today. And we need to talk about hydrostatic pressure because it's very important in the subsurface. And so hydrostatic pressure is a head, and we express it as a density gradient. In our industry, we use PSI per foot, is English units. And if we look at that concept, we can see I have two columns of fluid and a pressure gauge. And in this case, it's filled with water, which is about 8.3 pounds per gallon. And in this case, we have 16.5 pounds per gallon. So this fluid is more dense. And so the weight of the column of this fluid, in this case, raises that pressure gauge. And you can think about this when you go swimming. You guys, when you go in the swimming pool and you dive down to get that quarter of the bottom of the pool, what happens to your ears? Well, your ears begin to feel that hydrostatic head pressure. And so that has happened over geological time. As rock is deposited, there is fluid inside the sand grains, and it gets compressed with time. And we call that fluid pressure pore pressure inside the rock. Now, the other side to that is that rock will break. If you pump an incompressible fluid, a liquid into it, and you keep pumping and pumping and pumping, eventually you'll go above the tensile strength of that rock, and you'll crack that rock open. And that's a good thing for our industry, because we use that technique. You'll hear a lot about producing gas from shales. Well, that's what we're doing, is we're cracking the rock in the shales to get the gas out. But when we're drilling a well, this is not good, because we don't want to lose control. We don't want to lose expensive drilling mud. And so we must stay below the weight of the mud column, that hydrostatic head of that mud. It has to be enough to control the pore pressure, but it has to be below this fracture gradient. Okay, so remember that thought. We're going to come back to that thought. This is just a picture of a land drilling rig, just to make sure we all kind of know a little bit about this. And so when we drill for oil and gas, we'll actually have a drill bit on the bottom of a drill string. And the drill bit, this is a trichome bit. It could look like a donut and be diamond insert. There's lots of kinds of bits for different types of rocks. But the basic concept is this will be turning around. The whole bit itself, the whole rod string will be turning. And then if it's a trichome bit, each one of these combs will be turning as well, because fluid will be sent down the drill string and it will come up the annulus. So it go down the middle, and then in between the pipe and the hole, the wall of the well you're drilling, it will be returned up. The mud will be conditioned on the surface, pumped back up and down in the well. So if we're gaining mud, we know we're taking some influx. We call that a kick. If we're gaining mud at the surface, we know we're getting fluid into the system. If we're losing mud level, we know we're losing mud to the system. So that's how we know we monitor some things that might not be going right.
You said you were conditioning the mud. What is conditioning the mud?
Well, when we condition the mud, we remove the particulates, because when we drill, it's going to cut the little pieces of rock. We have to remove those, and we constantly check physical properties, like its rheology, like its viscosity, its ability to form a filter cake. Because here's what we're going to be doing. The mud, when it comes down the hole, like I mentioned, is going to be coming down the drill pipe, inside the drill pipe, through the drill bit, and coming up in the annulus. As it comes up in the annulus, the rock has open space in it. It has pores in it. And so one of the properties of the drilling mud is to make a small filter cake, a barrier, so that we control the fluid loss here. And so we constantly measure and condition to make sure that its filter cake properties are kept correct, and its yield point, its gel strength, things like that. Okay, so the drilling mud leaks off a little bit until it forms that filter cake. The mud also lubricates and cools the bit as we drill, and very importantly, it raises those cuttings to surface. But here's what we want to talk about with Macondo, is that this mud provides that hydrostatic pressure to control the pore pressure. Because if the weight of this mud isn't high enough, then fluid from the rock can flow into the wellbore. So we calculate it with English units. This is just a conversion factor, is 0.052, the density of the mud in pounds per gallon and the height. And the people on the rig are constantly monitoring this mud weight.
It's in the mud.
Barite, it's not like soil. It's a special barite and just water, basically. And we put different chemical additives in it to again control its properties. But it's not like soil. It's, when we say mud, it's because it's barite. That's a weighting agent, and bentonite. Bentonite is the main component. Barite's a weighting agent. Okay.
I can see how mud leaks, but how do you get a kick?
How do you get a kick?
Mud, you see, if you want mud coming down.
If you get a kick, what's going to happen? Well, we may be getting ahead of ourselves, but it's good to talk. It's a good question to ask now. If you get a kick, and this is just showing cracks, if you have too much pressure, overburden, you'll crack that rock and it'll leak off, or it'll go into any natural fractures too. If you get a kick, you're going to be drilling into a porous, say, sand, like this looks very laminated, like it's a sand and a shale and a sand and a shale, but you'll get to a formation where it'll be very thick sand. And that thick sand will maybe be a differential pressure, like let's say that the weight of this mud column's 8,000 psi. You drill into a sand that's 10,000 psi, you have a 2,000 psi differential, and that's just enough pressure, that's plenty of pressure. 100 psi is plenty of pressure to start taking care of. Now, periodically we stop and run casing, and we're going to talk about this why. I just wanted to show you a picture of it. This is what casing looks like. It's just pipe. That's all it is. It's just pipe. And so this may be a little hard to see, but this is the pipe in the solid gray. Here's the cement. We pump cement behind the pipe, and this is the formation. And this is just a diagram of how we represent it diagrammatically. Now, as we drill a well, we run more than one string of pipe. We'll spud in with a short piece, we'll run a longer piece, and they'll be successively placed at succeeding depths, and they'll be getting smaller diameter because they have to fit inside each other. Okay? We'll come back to that. So we generally cement them, we do cement them in the hole. We don't necessarily cement every string back into the previous one. It just depends on the situation. On onshore, we cement, we're required by law to cement to protect sources of drinking water. Those strings of pipe are cemented all the way back to surface. That's by regulation. Now you know everything you need to know to understand the track, right? You know everything you need to know. Okay. So here's a core problem. Drillers are stuck between two things. They're stuck between the black line, which is the pore pressure, the fluid pressure in the rock that you have to stay above to stop the influx, but they're stuck below the red line, which is the point at which the rock will crack. And they have to maintain mud weights in between those points. Well, the way in which they do that, they'll start off with a mud weight and come down, and then when this mud weight gets to this point, it would be too high. At some point, the pore pressure will get too high. This mud weight here, if we just kept all the way to bottom, it wouldn't be high enough to control this increasing pore pressure. So we stop there and we run a casing string. We set the casing string, we weight up the mud, and we do it again. We keep drilling then, and this mud weight here will contain all this increasing pore pressure. But wait a minute, we get here and what happens? Here is the same problem. Now, if we drill all the way down with this mud weight, we wouldn't be able to control this pore pressure. So we do the same thing again. We set casing, we weight up, and we do the same thing all the way to TD. And so it's the mud weight window that determines where we're going to set our casing. We're going to drill away. That's it.
But how do you know where those?
That's a very insightful question. Hopefully you've drilled enough of in a basin to know that. But you don't always know that. And that in essence is one of the things that happens frequently in very deep water. We don't have enough experience to know this with great certainty. And I actually cut out one of the slides, I think I'll have to go to it to see if I did. But one of the things in the BP well is that we have a plan, we have a drilling plan that says this is going to be my casing points, and then they get out there and they find out the pore pressures are a little bit different as they drill along, and so they have to modify the casing plan. And they actually ended up putting in very different casing, many more strings than they thought, than they originally planned to, because you don't always know this with certainty. That was a very good question. Yes?
So the black line is the hydrostatic pressure from the mud column?
The black line is the hydrostatic pressure inside the rock. It's the pore pressure that's trapped inside the rock from the fluid in the rock. The mud column is the blue. This is what you're controlling as you're drilling. You're controlling the mud pressure, and that mud weight has to stay above that pore pressure but below the fracture gradient of the rock.
So the red is like the tensile strength?
Well, it's more than the tensile strength, but that's one factor in calculating. Breakdown pressure is tensile strength plus a function of the minimum and maximum in situ stresses as well.
So whenever we have the blue line going straight down, that means they're just drilling without adding more mud to the column.
That means they're not adding more weight to the mud. They're not, the mud has a constant density to it. Just like if you had a swimming pool, and the swimming pool's filled with water, but if you filled your swimming pool up with, what's more dense than water? It would be just so much more dense. It would just weigh so much more at the bottom. So a constant blue line means it'd be just like having a constant water weight. In this case, it's probably about that, because it looks like it's about like water here. Here's five. So this is not, here it looks like maybe this is about seven, so it's not very weighty. But here we're already at, what is this, 11 and a half? Almost, yeah, 11.7 pounds per gallon. This is definitely weighted up with ferrite.
Earlier you said when you got to the horizontal blue lines, it indicated you had to put a casing plate?
That's where you really need to put a casing plate.
So as you're drilling down, you're going to have some spaces where it's just the rock, and then others where you need to put additional casing in, or is the casing going all the way down?
Well, I think you're going to see a good picture that's going to show you that. So can we maybe and if you come back and ask that question again, if the pictures don't clarify that question. Okay, now here's just a little example. This is an example, and I want to point your attention to the fact that this is actually from a jackup. So this is very shallow water, because this is a drilling unit whose legs are resting on the seafloor. This blue is water. And this is just an example which has some weird things in it, but I like this example because, and I'll tell you what the weird things are, but I like it because it shows a nice picture. These are different subsurface formations. This is layers, and here we have two faults in the subsurface where there's been movement, and these formations that are numbered have been displaced from each other. And here we have oil that's trapped against this fault in a porous sand. This is a porous sand. These are something else. I guess this is supposed to be shale. So if we step through this, we have spudded in or drilled in a structural piece of casing. Now we've drilled a hole, and we've run another piece of pipe into that hole. Now you're going to see a close-up where we've pumped in cement from the bottom of the hole back behind that piece of pipe, and we've cemented all the way back up into the previous string. Now we drill the next through this, and it looks like this. We just drilled through it. And in this case, we've drilled through it and we've done the same thing. It might be a little bit hard to see with the lighting in here, but there is actually another piece of pipe, drilled through, set the pipe. We drill through first, then we run the pipe, then we run the cement. And then we drill out through that. This is an open hole. And then they're going to set another piece of pipe through that, which is run all the way back to the surface. Each piece of pipe is getting successively narrower or smaller diameter so it can fit through the previous one. And then finally, drilling into the target with this last little bit of open. And so that's just a general idea of how we would drill. This is being drilled directionally. Our industry is so sophisticated, we rival NASA. One of the good things about the BP experience is that people got to see through webcam just how high-tech our industry is. A lot of people think we're like Jed Clampett. I kid you not. And I think that's a very important thing. Basically, we can drill, you draw it, we can drill it, is our motto. We can drill just about any direction.
How do you change that?
Well, I could come back and talk about that. But basically, we have what are called directional bits. And so these bits are designed to rotate the bit without rotating the drilling string. So basically my arm, the drilling string, could be stationary, not rotating. The bit is rotating. And then we'll have a sub, a short assembly in here, that will have an angle built into it. And by adjusting that bit, rotating that bit, and controlling the angle of the sub, because They can even be hydraulically controlled. The angle, 2 degrees, 3 degrees, we can actually slide along, drill along, and move in direction. It is the most amazing technology. Unbelievable things that this is. And I know it's hard to say to explain that without a picture, so I can come back and talk about that. Or you could invite Dr. Nygaard, who's our drilling professor. Okay, we're gonna return to our mudway window, and this is where I say this isn't the best example in the world because it doesn't have the vertical lines in it. They mix a couple of things, pressures and gradients, but let's not get bogged down into that because I just want to show you the principle again. So this is from Matthews Daniel, and I want to give them credit for this example where I borrow this. I like this example because this is really important in deep water. Remember, the driller has to stay in between, and unfortunately, they haven't used the straight line in this. They're showing it like they're increasing the mud weight. Ignore that. Just focus on the casing points. Here's the flat bit again. Here's the casing point. Here's the pore pressure. Here's the mud weight in between. Here's the mud weight. We wanted to drop it here for some reason in this example we just drilled. We set the casing point, and then mud weight down, casing point, and drilled in. So this is the mud weight following the example we just looked at. Okay, we're going to come back to that again, and I'm sure that will generate some more questions. Now we want to make sure that we don't make that MSNBC CNN mistake. You notice I didn't say Fox. They make mistakes too. But these are drilling rigs. These are not production facilities. These are drilling rigs. And so this is a drilling rig that's on a platform sitting on the seabed. It's a little hard to see with the lighting, this color. But then this is more on a permanent facility. It's not going to move. But back here in this picture is a jackup rig. It floats out to sea with its legs extended vertically, and then they move the legs, it's actually floating, and then they jack the legs downward until they hit the seafloor, which in continued jacking motion raises the jackup up to the position you see it here. Because it's a bottom-supported drilling rig, 350 feet, 450 feet for Rowan class is about all it can do. Beyond about 450 feet, you've got to have floating facilities. And this is called a semi-submersible. It can be tethered, it could be non-tethered. Tether meaning just moored down to the sea with anchors. But it has ballast control that keeps pumping water in and out and keeps it in position. This is a drill ship, and this is going back to the tension leg platform again. This is what causes confusion, is because people mix these. This is a production facility. Because it's tethered to the seafloor, it's going to stay there. Again, this tends to be thought of as a production facility. These are your main drilling units, the jackup, the semi-submersible, and the drill ship. This is the Deep Horizon rig that caught on fire from Macondo well. This is under tow. This is a semi-submersible. When they get it out on site, the barge would lower it down, it would come off, and then it would be, these legs are hollow and they would be flooded with water. So that this would be ballasted downward to reduce its center of gravity. And then it may or may not be moored. It may be just kept on station with dynamic positioning. So this is the actual rig before it goes on site.
So that's a drilling rig.
This is a drilling rig.
And so after it gets done drilling, it's moved.
Yes, correct.
They put it in a production.
And they put it in a production facility. And what happens in, because of the time value of money, this is what I try to tell from economics class, it's that money 1 year from now is worth so much more than money 5 years from now, if you calculate the discount rate. And so what happens, especially in deep water, is nowadays we want to drill those wells before we bring out that production facility. So these semi-submersibles and drill ships are out there drilling these wells and then suspending them so that when the production facility is built, it'll come out, be put in place, all those wells will be tied back on, and boom, 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 a lot of production will be brought into play. They'll be brought on production. If you had to bring out a production facility and drill one well, and then drill another well, and then drill another well, it would so severely adverse project economics, many of these projects would just be uneconomical. So what's happening out there is many of these wells are being pre-drilled. That was a very good question. So, but sometimes they're just drilling new wells. They're subsea wells that would be tied into something else. This is a drill ship. They're ocean-going vessels. They have a big advantage. So the semi that you just saw is good around 6,000, 7,000 feet of water. You can stretch it even more. But when you get into 10,000 feet of water, 9,000 feet of water, we're going to talk about you're going to see the marine riser. The marine riser becomes so heavy, it's hard for a semi to carry it. And so when we go into ultra deep water, like 10,000 feet of water, you're going to see these drill ships. They can move faster. Some semi-submersibles can move under their own power. But a lot of them, if you just seen them, they're barged because they can just barge them faster. This is a fully ocean-going vessel. In this picture, you can't see it, maybe you can see it a little bit. There's actually two derricks on this rig instead of one. And dual derricks are used in a lot of ultra deep water because twice as fast, faster, better economics. So what makes it so costly? I've got $100 million up there. $100 million. That's a lot. Did you know that these wells are costing $50 to $100 million each? That's a huge amount of money. So why do they cost so much money? Why is it so difficult out there? Well, number one is that mud weight window that we've been talking about, it gets smaller. And we're gonna talk about why it gets smaller. And when the mud weight window gets smaller, it makes their life tough. In addition to that, is they have to connect a marine riser, and the deeper the water, the bigger and heavier, the heavier and longer, it's just so much more complex to hang it out there. It also contains, yes?
How deep is the actual well from the seafloor?
It could be anything. It could be, in this case, a Macondo, it was 18,000 feet from the seafloor.
So then you've got 18,000 plus your other...
Plus another 6,000 feet of marine riser.
Uh-huh.
5,000 feet. Yeah. That's why I say, our technology rivals NASA. Most people don't understand that. But you're going to understand that. You already understand that. Okay. So, the long marine riser is very hard to handle. Big mud volume can fracture shallow sediments, but the other thing is, I'm used to waving my hands in class, you can tell that. So the other thing is, when we have a platform, or we're drilling from a platform, usually our device called a blowout preventer is on the platform. When we go into drilling from a floating vessel, the blowout preventer is always on the seafloor. I have lots of good stories to tell about this. I spent a whole summer on jackups and semis when I was much, much younger. Okay. Here's what a marine riser looks like stacked on a drill ship. The sections are about 50 feet long, about 21 inches in diameter, and they weigh tons. People don't pick these up, right? Machines pick these up and connect them, and then they're lowered section by section to the seafloor.
It's not a garden hose.
It's not a garden hose. They weigh a lot. And because they weigh a lot, we use Archimedes' principle of buoyancy to try to reduce their weight by wrapping them up in flotation. And so it's not the wheel you see on the outside if they're all wrapped with flotation, so that once you get them in the water, they weigh less. Because this whole thing has to be kept under tension. It can't be sloughed off like this. That marine riser has to be under tension. Because if you lose tension on that marine riser, you're going to have all sorts of mechanical problems, vibration, vortex-induced vibration, all sorts of other things. Even you may have that even under tension. You have to keep this marine riser. Here's a picture of installing the blowout preventer with a marine riser. And the blowout preventer is being run to the seafloor. And offshore, when I talked about pre-drilling these wells, I didn't show this. My other sequence was drilling from a platform, but our floater would have drilled these sections of pipe. After normally what is the 20-inch section, we cement back to the surface, then we install until this blowout preventer. This is all the marine riser, lowers it down until the blowout preventer is attached. And then the brown in here is the drill pipe being run. It all runs through the blowout prevention. I want to thank at this point, and I'll Dr. Gunnar Nygaard is our drilling professor, and he has kindly provided a lot of these slides, but these slides are actually from, many of these are from the blowout, the BOP official public document, and I've left a copy of that document on the desktop. If anyone wants to read the 200 pages, and don't call me up and ask me to explain all the details, but that is there where some of these have come from. So I want to thank him for that. And this is a picture of a blowout preventer, and all a blowout preventer is a bunch of valves. That's all it is. But they do different things. And so at the top, you'll have the annular preventer, and they also call it a bag preventer, and it looks like a donut, and it's meant to just close off totally, like this, just squeeze off. You have some blind rams, shear rams, that are intended to cut the pipe in an emergency. And then you also have these pipe rams. The pipe rams are meant to clamp around the pipe and hold it. So you could actually use the blowout preventer if you have a disconnect joint to hang off and move the rig away. And indeed, they didn't leave pipe in the well, but indeed, actually in the Macondo well, it had been drilled by another rig. They stopped because the hurricane had come. They moved off that rig off, and they came back with the steep water horizon. But that's kind of a sidebar.
Once the blowout preventer does its work, the well's kaput. You can't go back to it anymore?
No.
You broke it?
In the case where a blowout preventer works correctly, it's designed to shut in, hopefully through, not through cutting the pipe, but hopefully one of the ram that closes in the well. And then there are choke and kill lines. And that's a good question too, because the choke and kill lines stab in. Let's go back. I don't know if you can't really see them very well, but there are choke and kill lines that are built in integrally with the marine riser section. They're little bitty conduits of pipe that are physically attached to each section, and they stab, one section stabs into the other, so that they connect down to your choke and kill line. So if your well is going out of control and you close in the blowout preventer, then you can circulate out the well and kill, you can pump in mud and circulate out through your choke and kill lines on the blowout preventer. That's the way it should work. But it didn't. Here's the physical reason why the mud wake window closes in deep water. And again, this is a long presentation. I appreciate your patience in going through a lot of these principles. But normally, when we drill, if we imagine a depth, just an arbitrary depth, normally when we drill all through land, through rock, it would have a fracture gradient, a breakdown of about 1 psi per foot, give or take. But when we go into deep water, we are effectively removing half of that rock, or a large portion of it. The deeper the water, the more equivalent rock we're removing. And that gradient is seawater. And it's only about 0.445, give or take some salinity and temperature. It's a lot less than rock. The net effect of this, we could do a calculation, but I just don't bore you with numbers, but we do this in my offshore class. The net effect of this is to reduce the overburden. And this translates into needing a lot more casing strings just because of this physical phenomenon. And effectively what it does is it reduces the fracture gradient. And so it makes the mud wake window tighter. Now let's look at this example. I've taken back something from Matthew's Daniel. Same kind of thing, but now we're in deep water. We don't have that little itty bitty blue bit on a platform or a jackup. We now get a floating facility, a drill ship, drilling to our target. And we have the same situation before. This was what we had before. If you remind yourself, the fracture gradient and the pore pressure. But now, actually, we're in deep water, and so our fracture gradient, if you saw that kind of shift to the left, it should left, and we have two problem points. We have a problem point here, potentially, it's real close, but we definitely have a problem point right here because the projected mud wave is going to be less than the pore pressure right here at 3. So here's what happens. In deep water, in this case, we would be forced to move the previous casing string up a little and accommodate an insert, which effectively allows us to then increase the mud weight over this little trouble spot. Does that make sense? And so this is what they originally, I did include that. This is what they originally planned to do at the BP well. And so we have 1, 2, 3, that's our structural pipe, so really 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, this is their inner liner, their inner production string, or their main string. But this is what they ended up doing. And there's more casing strings in this well, because exactly what the question you asked, how did they know that? Well, they didn't. They fought that well. They fought that well the whole way down. That pore pressures were higher than they expected, and you can't read it, but up here, if you were to read it, 8.6, 8.7, 8.7, 9.0, 10.1, these are the mud weight windows, basically, they're play in mud weights. They're so tight, they were struggling the whole way down to drill this, and as they struggled, they were forced to set more strings of pipe in this well. But that really wasn't the main problem. And this is only my opinion, Dr. Nygaard's opinion I'm conveying to you. So let's talk about maybe what were some problems. Why? What did they do? What are our technologies to deal with this? Well, why? They had an open annulus. We know that, and we're going to show you that and talk about that. They had a poor cement job, and we're going to talk about that. And we know there were some issues with the blowout preventer. Beyond that, you know, there may have been some, there are interpretive issues that maybe we don't go into today. But here's a picture of all the pipe that was in the well and then the final string. What they originally planned to do was to set a 9 7/8 inch string, but they ended up running a 7 inch, well, they're going to run a 7 inch to another 9 5/8 above it. And so they were 21 days behind schedule. What's the cost per day? $1 million. You're 21 days behind schedule. And all you want to do is just get this over with. You're 21 days behind schedule. Everybody's frustrated with this. And so it takes more time to do this. And so they decided that, sorry, that this is what they did. This is what they were arguing about doing. One of the options of what they were planning to do is to run a liner and then tie back that liner, stab another piece of pipe. This is commonly done. And when you would stab in, you would put a barrier right here when you stab in and do this procedure with a 9 7/8. Surprise, it's not 9 5/8. Tie that. But then you would normally put this barrier here. But they didn't do that. They ran this liner to this tieback, and there was no, because of this decision, there was absolutely no barrier. Here's the cement from the well, and you can see there's an open annulus behind this seven inch all the way up to the well. There's no barrier. And so, is that a bad decision? In hindsight, I think, you know, we have to ask ourselves a question.
Is that something that you could pull off somewhere else?
Yes. Well, yes. If you didn't have this problem, it's another problem. And you know, this is one of the things that there's going to be a slide coming up. You know, when you have a disaster, it's never one thing, it's a bunch of things. That's usually what sets up the major disaster scenarios. But that in itself, if the cement job had been really fine, it probably would have been okay. So now let's talk about the cement job. When we cement casing in the well, we put something called a centralizer on it. And this is one style. They're not all necessarily the style. This is a bow style centralizer. And these are thin pieces of metal, so they compress inward. And they're strapped around the drill pipe. And we put them every so much distance because, believe it or not, you know, if you hold up a wet noodle, you know how a noodle just kind of flops around? Well, that's what pipe will do inside the earth because it's warm down there. Pipe actually will just be like a noodle, even big diameter pipe. And so if the well bore is never truly vertical, even a vertical well, so it's going to have a tendency to lay to one side. And so we want to get that cement to flow up smoothly. We want the pipe to be in the middle of the hole. And so we put these centralizers on that pipe to keep the pipe in the center of the hole so we can get the cement to be in, because otherwise we'd get all the cement on one side and none on the other. And then we have the flow channel. In very deep water, because the hydrostatic head that we talked about, our swimming pool, of all the fluids becomes so high, we're cementing with foam cement. The nitrogen in the cement reduces the weight of the cement that we're putting in there. And we don't understand the foam cement absolutely. These are technologies that are still evolving, in a sense. And so Halliburton has a program to predict how many of these would properly centralize the pipe given the rheological properties of the foam cement and how it would flow, given the temperature, the pressure, the depth, all those, the size of the hole, etc., and the angle. And so Halliburton said, you know, guys, you're going to have a problem if you only run 10 of these. You need to run more of these. And they said, oh, no, well, Halliburton said, you need 21, and, you know, that clock is ticking, and more time, and more money, and I think the problem was they didn't have that many out there. They were going to have to wait to get up. There was some issue. I didn't have to go back on the first round, but there was an issue with, I think they didn't have 21 of these. And so they said, oh, no. And I think they had six or seven of them out there, and Halliburton said, you know, this is going to be a problem. And they said, we've done it before, we'll get away with it, no problem. Was it a bad decision? I don't know. I'm only here to point out things that are in the public report, okay?
Who was saying no, BP or Transocean?
Halliburton had a physical model. Halliburton had a physical model said that with seven centralizers, their reports came up with a warning that there could be a severe gas flow because that pipe wouldn't be centered in the hole. Cement would be all on one side, leaving a gaping hole potentially on one side because the pipe would be centralized.
Whose final decision made that they would use such?
The final decision would be the company paying for drilling the well.
Were they on the platform?
On the rig? The way it's structured is that there's a main drilling representative from BP on the rig, and then Transocean would have a main representative on the rig. But they would both be falling short. So I cannot say. I don't know whose decision it was.
That
answers
the question.
I answered the question. Okay. Halliburton
was responsible for what?
The cementing job.
Okay.
And they knew, all they said was, hey, this looks like it could be a problem.
So how big are these things?
You mean at least? Well, they've got to fit around the pipe. So if the drill pipe is going to be smaller than the bit. So in this section, I think this was a 9 5/8 section. So this might have been 7 inch. But these are not really huge. They'll probably be a couple of feet long, 2-3 feet long, depending on their style. But they're not big devices. I mean, all they're meant to do is make point contact with the wall of the hole to keep the pipe in the middle. Because otherwise it's going to sag. And they need to be a fairly close distance apart too. You know, the fewer there are, the longer the distance between, and the pipe can sag in between them. So, there are lots of pictures in that 200-page report, and I don't want to go over how to cement a well, but basically we do the same thing. When we cement a well, we pump down, there's some equipment downhole that has back check flow valves in it, the cement comes up, and in this case, the volumes were fine, the cement came above. This is a picture of the the producing zones, those thick sand bodies that had all the, have all the oil in them, the cement comes up, and then normally you allow it to sit for 48 hours to harden. After 48 hours, that other equipment set, maybe with a lockdown, maybe not, they can pull out the pipes and disengage. They'll flush the marine riser with water, disengage the marine riser. They'll set some temporary plugs at the top too. Then they'll disengage the marine riser and move away. So in the case of this well, one of the things that is in the report is that they didn't wait full 48 hours. They began doing a water displacement from, there was still drill pipe in the hole to do this water displacement, and displacing up the marine riser. But as they were doing that, they started having some early detection of inflow, what we call kink. And there are a lot of pictures in that report, and I don't want to go into all the details of that. I think the main point is that there were tests, there were hydrostatic tests going on in this well, which were not interpreted correctly. They argued about these tests, about, you know, if you were to drain your hot water heater at home, if you were going to work on your hot water heater, and my husband's going to laugh at this example because I never fix anything at home, he's actually laughing, but if you were to drain your hot water heater, I mean, you shut off your main water valve, drain the hot water heater, and it would go to zero pressure. And then if you went to look at the hot water heater and suddenly your valve was still closed, you think, and suddenly your hot water heater had 20 pounds of pressure on it, you go, that's kind of strange. And then you drain the pressure off, and then you go back to work on it, and there was 20 pounds of pressure back on it, you'd start to think your valve was leaking, right? It's that same analogy would be true here, is they were looking at the drill pipe pressure and then the backside pressures that they were monitoring on the annulus.
So they were starting to get mud back into the holding tanks at a rate higher than they typically would see, which was giving them a warning that they were having problems holding that well?
You know, here's the answer to that would be theoretically, yes, they would have. But here's the problem. It wasn't like on land where there was a holding tank sitting right next to them and they were going, I see there's more mud coming in there. That by that point, they were offloading to another vessel. And so their storage was going to another vessel. And so there were so many things happening so quickly to them, they couldn't do exactly what you're describing. They couldn't look down and say, oh yeah, I see mud's coming in on me. What they were seeing were pressure tests that really, I'd have to come back and probably spend another hour talking about these tests. But they were seeing pressure tests and looking at pressure differentials that were really not well understood what was going on. And there's no question.
A couple of days ago, the government allowed deep water drilling in the Gulf to start again, and they said it was going to be safer this time because the government was going to follow their procedures and they were going to be more careful with their checking the rigs. Does that make sense to you?
Well, you know, that's a very complex question. I definitely agree with continuing drilling. First of all, let me say that. I think the government saying we're going to stop drilling is akin to having an automobile accident and saying we're going to stop manufacturing cars.
Right.
I think that now having closer oversight and maybe going back and watching maybe more carefully about all these steps and not saying, well, yes, that was okay over there, so it'll probably work over here, is going to benefit everybody. So I think it's a yes on both answers. You know, yes, it was the right decision to go back and drill, and yes, it's the right decision. One of the things I personally feel is, like the partners in this situation, Anadarko, they got daily reports in the mail. They weren't out there. You know, this $100 million, it wasn't all BP's money because they have partners in this venture. Very few companies sustain, they own a certain percentage of the reservoir, so the cost of the well is apportioned to them in relationship to the how they own the reserves. And so Anadarko had 25% of the well, I don't remember the exact number. And so they had no control over what was going on, and the insurers. And so if we had a system of real-time monitoring where those reports and what's going on is shared and monitored in real time, I think there's a lot of scope for that. And that's one of the things I'm hoping to work on with some colleagues of mine, is real-time monitoring and sharing of information.
I thought the blowout valve preventer was an automatic thing. That when the pressure got too great, it would seal it off.
Well, yes, it does have some automatic controls, but in general, somebody
has to activate.
Has to activate.
Maybe he answered his question, but was there anything that could have been done? Was there a point of no return?
By the time that it was shooting up through the, by the time that the mud and everything shot up the hole, that was pretty much the point of no return. It was out of control by that point. I mean, what, as you're taking the influx, that's your opportunity to immediately begin wading up and circulating. But they had displaced that heavy mud with water. You seen this picture? They had displaced this with water. That aggravated the inflow problem by removing the weight of the mud and displacing it to a less dense water. That aggravated the problem.
Was that the problem with the crystals or something? Was
the hydrant? No, we're going to talk about that too. I'm just amazed you guys are still here listening to this so long.
That's because they were in a hurry to do this water thing.
You know, they were in a hurry to do all this. Well, I guess, you know, it's just a lot of things. I don't want to blame BP entirely, but you know, you're on this well, you're way overspent, 21 days. Everybody wants to get it done. You know, 2 days later, this rig was scheduled to be somewhere else. You know, there's a lot of factors, human factors, that go into this.
The horizontal scale of the mud is that 21 days.
This is time. Time. This is time. This is time in minutes. This is what, 9 o'clock at night?
9:30,
9:32, 9:34.
So the whole thing went to hell.
Yeah, but okay. Can you say that though? No. It didn't go. I mean, but what you don't see is the time before this, the 4 hours before this, I cut out of this presentation. I have a lot of slides still coming. 4 hours before this, there were those hot water things going on that were the preliminary indications that something wasn't right. I didn't realize I was going to generate some questions. Okay, so this is just leak pass at the end of the day. And this was just BP saying they think the check valves maybe didn't hold in. So all that stuff going out of the Gulf is coming here. I think personally it's probably much more probable their leak path was up the inroads. But that's an issue. Okay. Some personal views. These are from Dr. Nyberg, but I wholeheartedly agree. This disaster follows a big typical pattern. Multiple things come together to cause the issue. Having only one barrier behind the pipe, just the fluid behind the pipe, having no cement or no other barriers is not a good idea in that case of design. The lack of centralizers was well known to be a red flag issue. The well test, the things that, when I'm talking about those hot water issues, the pressure going on, that was actually started to be conducted too early before the 48 hours that we normally allow cement to be set. And so knowledge about the foam cement, we don't, you know, absolutely don't have complete knowledge about that, how it sets, how it behaves down the wall. The blowout preventer maintenance was not very good. That seems that the leak was a leak point too. And the well integrity test, what I'm talking about, those pressures, it was interpreted incorrectly. And because they interpreted that pressure on the backside, pressure in the drill pipe incorrectly, they went ahead and circulated the well to water before setting any other barriers. All of these were factors. somehow, more than likely, maybe one was a trigger point, but very likely most of these had some impact.
I understand that they had, long before this, had materials from one of the seals that had come up through the mud. So they knew that that the blowout preventer did have some problems.
Yeah, but you know, those are the sorts of things that they're accustomed to not being a major issue. You know, and I don't want you to say, oh, well, a little piece of rubber came up and so it's the whole system's gonna fail. And I think anybody who works like I know there's an expert here in the room in building maintenance. If you saw a little tiny piece of Teflon from Teflon tape go through, that doesn't mean a whole Teflon wrap has gone bad. You know what I'm saying? So, yeah, it might have been a reason to say, oh, yeah, let's make a note of this, but it wouldn't have been enough justification to shut down the whole blowout operation.
Did the blowout preventer actually fail or wasn't activated?
Well, let's go back. What happened was, I'm going to have to go through back through a lot of slides. What happened was it was leaking. You can see that in what's going on here.
Oh,
it's
okay.
It's not closed, it's not holding the pressure. So the annular, that top donut, the one that closes, the annular valve, that's your one that seals off entirely, the annular valve was leaking. And then it just gave way because it was leaking and it just gave way. Couldn't sustain the situation.
You mentioned lack of knowledge about the foam cement at those significant depths.
Incomplete.
So still studying it. Who manufactures it?
Yeah, but having foam cement at 14.7 psi and 60 degrees Fahrenheit is a whole lot different than having foam cement at 400 Fahrenheit at 27,000 feet in subsurface. And so it's only being raised as not complete knowledge. You know, it's not a perfect set of knowledge. But still, there's work to be done probably understanding its flow behaviors and characteristics. So here's, after the blowout, one side trying to sustain it. So I thought it would be interesting to include some of the things that Dr. Nygaard had presented in what we do afterwards, because we all know what happened. And it's kind of archaic, and this is where we can really make some big improvements. Is we go down, we don't send divers down there because divers can't go that deep. We send remotely operated vehicles to go down there and try to close the valves on the blowout preventer. Or we just try to collect the oil and do something with it, dispose of it, or we drill a relief well. And those are the three things that they tried to do. And so here's pictures that many of you may have pulled off the BP website, but it's in their report as well. Is the ROV coming in and trying? Here's the riser pipe all crumpled up here on C4. And obviously that didn't work. Here's a picture of, obviously there was a lot of collection going on, and then from the collection, trying to just burn off the oil. But we recently had a speaker come from the geophysical side talking about fluids. And you know, one of the reasons people are surprised that this oil went away is Mother Nature deals with hydrocarbon as a natural product. Hydrocarbon is a naturally occurring product. And so Mother Nature is well equipped to degrade it, actually. All of the very light ends, hydrocarbon is just carbon and hydrogen linked together. And so gas is like methane, ethane, propane, C1, H4, C2, H6. And so the sea is loaded with bacteria and it's a great environment. The minute that oil hit, all that bacteria went to work and it stripped off all the light ends, the C1, H4, C2, H6, and C1, H2 plus N. All the light ends were stripped off and the heavier stuff sank to the seafloor. And so that really should be no surprise to us as scientists that that's where it ended up.
So is this just spatial faster than the extra values? Dissipation of this oil and bacteria and so forth in the ocean faster than the Exxon Valdez spill 30 years ago.
You know, I don't think I really know, can answer that question entirely, but it would be similar. I mean, those are two different environments. You know, Valdez washed up the coast and so they have clean
corrosive, just something. But Mother Nature will eventually, you know, do some work sorting that out too.
Here's the first relief well, because that's our other thing, started in May. And here's what you asked about, the ice crystals. Amazingly, this was the first thought, we'll just stick a multi-ton dome on top of it, and we'll just, so much weight, we'll just, boom, we'll just set it down, and that's how we do it. And so here's the dome, the hat, and they just didn't think about this, which is kind of surprising, because this is a big problem in deep water facilities for naturally occurring gas hydrates. And what happens in a hydrate is a water molecule, when it begins to form a solid, makes a cage. And the gas molecules, the very light ones, C1H4, C2H6, they get trapped inside this cage. And it locks up and it looks like dirty ice. And that's called a natural gas hydrate. And they form at depth, well, at pressure. And pressure in this picture has been translated into depth, so this would be like the seafloor. And at low temperature, well, at very deep water depths, it's very low temperature. And we have this problem in our flow lines. So there was a whole flow assurance group at BP. But you know, I'm sure that there was just so much immediacy and things going on that there wasn't really time spent thinking all this out. So what happens is, in this region then, these ice crystals form, and they're not ice, these naturally occurring gas hydrates, because all the gas is bubbling out of the well with the oil, and that gas is going in solution in the water nearby, in the sea water, some of the gas goes in solution, and it's cold, and so here comes this hat, and the whole thing just starts to lock up with naturally occurring gas hydrates. And the whole thing just plugged up, and that was the end of that solution. And so then they decided, they have this term called top kill, I call it bullheading. Top kill is just pushing it in. Let's just flow it in to the top of the well and just try to push that heavy mud. That we calculate a mud density, that if we could push the mud down a certain distance, if we just pump with enough force, we could just get enough mud pushed down in that column so that the weight of this mud would then be higher, the hydrostatic head would be higher than that pressure coming from that reservoir. Well, they pumped in a lot of mud, and it just came right back out again because they just couldn't pump enough of it in with high enough pressure. The top kill was very dubious that that would work. I mean, again, that's a desperado. You know, it's easy. We know how to do it. Let's try it. And then they took their technology, and they started saying, we are the finest subsea engineers in the world. We know how to control and ballast, so we'll just set down and we'll just hold a cap. We may not get 100% of that oil, but we can monitor the weight on this and hold this cap on top of there well enough that, by gosh, we can get most of it. And that's what they did. And then after they did that, well, this is just a lovely picture with them on. Look at this. Now, there's an operational marvel managing this fleet of facilities. I don't care what anybody says about BP, just being able to mobilize and manage a fleet of this size is amazing. Because you got to keep them from running into each other. And what they did was remanufacture and install a no-blow-up preventer. And this is the last day, leakage stop, the 15th of July. They've installed a no-blow-up preventer, and the well is under control. And this is just a summary slide of how many people, because of these events, more than 47,800 people responding, 8 exploration production operators involved, hundreds of industry suppliers, 6,000 marine vessels, including about 5,800 BOOs, 60 water drilling vessels, 2 floating production storage and offloading facilities, 150 aircraft, and partners and governments from 19 countries talking about this and working together. Although maybe not legally on site. And so then finally, here come the relief wells, the first relief well. both started in early May, and the two relief wells coming from different directions, intersecting the well bore. This is a better picture. The relief wells are drilled. They have the ability to detect metal. They're guided in. They detect and cut into the well bore, and once then they intersect the well bore, the cement's pumped into the well, and the well is officially killed just by pumping cement in. The cement hardens, the well is killed. This well is also cemented off the relief well, and everything's pulled back out, and it's key takeaways. Confinement of the spill and removal oil is what we could expect today with what we knew how to do. We did what we knew how to do. They did. I didn't do it. They did it. They did what they knew how to do. The equipment for containing it was designed after this blowout occurred. They didn't design some of the stuff ahead of time. Installing the reinstalling a blowout preventer has never been done before. That broke new ground. But the outside community, like us and everybody else, we're really not given everything by BP. And so nobody else could really comment on, you know, what was really going on. The bigger impact, deep water drilling is going to continue to break barriers. I don't think that we're going to stop drilling in deep water. Why? Just as I started out in the very beginning of my talk, the very first picture, most of the shallow outer continental shelf is heavily developed. Our reserves are coming from deep water. To say we're going to stop drilling in deep water, now you understand the situation. If we stop drilling in deep water, we're going to very seriously adverse our reserves, because 25% of the oil in the United States comes from the Gulf of Mexico, and 60% of that is coming from deep water. But still, you know, there's a lot of things we can do better. We can monitor things better. We can have more strict procedures. And so, you know, I think those are definitely takeaways. A lot of people think of us as jet clampet. A lot of our young people are being taught to believe that we're going away, that we're going to be replaced by wind turbines, windmills, solar panels. And unfortunately, many people who are well-educated and know the facts can't seem to overcome some of those messages that are being driven to our young people. And so a lot of this research is going away and being done inside of companies, but now the majors are each contributing $250 million. Yes, that's $1 billion, the mega majors. $1 billion is now going into safety research as well. So that's a good outcome. Still a lot of unanswered questions. We don't have the data, my community doesn't. The technology to drill wells safely exists. The technologies to rapidly contain and stop a leak are now going to be evolving, I think, out of this. And finally, stopping drilling because of